Welcome to the Minnesotan Pod, brought to you today by our favorite hometown team, the Minnesota Wild. On today's pod, we get to meet Zach Palmquist, the new head coach for South St. Paul High School. Zach's last name is synonymous with the Packer program. His dad is the girls' coach dating back 30 years. After his playing days at South St. Paul, Zach starred at Minnesota State, earning all WCHA honors twice and second-team All-American his senior year. While at Mankato, Zach's Mavericks went to the NCAA tournament three times. Zach played 6 years pro, four in the American Hockey League and two in Sweden. He currently lives in Eagan with his wife, Vanessa, and his two kids, Asher and Evelina. Welcome to the show, Zach Palmquist.
Love is a burning thing, and it makes a fiery ring. Bound by wild desire, I fell into a ring of fire.
How you doing today, Zach?
Doing well, Tony. Thanks for having me on.
Good. It's been fun to get to know you in so many different ways. Normally, I meet hockey coach, have him come on, but our paths have crossed in innumerable ways. Number one, you were a mentor to my son Jake in your former company. He started, and he comes home, and like week one, he goes, "Guess who my mentor is? Zach Palmquist." And I wish I knew as much about you as I do today after doing research. But it's been fun to get to know you now, and through my son Jake.
No, likewise, it was fun getting to know your son, and I think mentor is maybe the wrong word there, but.
He liked you.
No, I'll take it. But yeah, you got a great son, and it's been great getting to know you as well.
Yeah, all right. So let's talk a little bit about just kind of the whole Packer aura. I brought it up in the intro a little bit. The Packer aura, South St. Paul. You pretty much could walk into South St. Paul's arena, see the big Packer head. You see the banners, you see the retired jerseys, and if you go to a game there, like I've been there, and the band's playing, you pretty much can't say no to the game of hockey.
No, I think you're spot on. I think it's a great atmosphere for high school hockey. It's a great barn, as they call it. So there's so much history, and you can just feel it right when you walk in. You see those banners. You see Doug Woog's name in there. You see Phil Housley, other players like Warren Miller.
Yeah.
You know, those teams that, you know, we all look back on and see the talent and the banners up top of how many state tournaments they went to. I mean, it's incredible. So the history is there, and it's fun to be a part of again.
All right, let's go through that. Like you mentioned just a couple names on there. I mean, two of the most obvious ones would be Doug Woog. Doug passed in the last 5 years, well-documented. The Gophers had Wooger jerseys the year he passed away, which I think was awesome. How well did you know Doug? And I think there's a real connection between Doug Woog and Dave Palmquist because they have a lot of the same. If you broke open the genotypes, they have a lot of very similar types. Talk a little bit about that as a comparison to your dad.
Yeah, I think it kind of dates back to probably early 2000, not early 2000s, but mid 2000s of, you know, my dad worked at Doug Woog's hockey camp that was up at Breezy Point for
forever.
15 years. Maybe. Yeah. I mean, that was my real introduction to Doug Woog. Was up at those camps. I mean, he was an on-ice skating instructor for those camps for a number of years. Doug was always so good to me and my family. I mean, he lived right down the road from us in South St. Paul as well. So I'd see him going on walks when I was younger before.
Really?
Middle school, high school. So, yeah, he was always right there, always so kind, would come down and talk with the high school teams down there, you know. Even though he had all of his stuff going on with Gopher hockey, all that sort of stuff, his camps in the summer. So Yeah, him and my dad were very close, and then it was great to get to know him through camps.
You know, here's a, I don't know how I got to this, but this is be for people who didn't know Doug, and this is just from, I didn't know him personally. I met him, oddly enough, I met him once, it's a good story, but for another day, but he, when you get released as the coach, because he wasn't necessarily, you know, he didn't necessarily resign as the coach per se, and usually a program where he had so much pride in that program and, you know, being a former player. But he went on to be this broadcaster who was almost as good a broadcaster as he was a coach. He was super excited about it. He was into it. You could just see it was just oozing out of him how much he loved the program. And for a guy that was fired, he sure did it with a ton of class, you know. Yeah. And that was like, I met him at a Gopher. This is the story. I met him at a Gopher event, and he came up and shook my hand, talked to us, you know, did the spiel. He meets every group and all 18 groups or whatever in the event or whatever. And he said to us, our foursome, we shook hands or whatever, and he was talking about players today, and that was back probably in the late 90s or whatever. He's like, yeah, a lot of these kids don't know how to shake hands. They don't know, you know, they didn't play other sports. They only know one thing. And he went into this whole thing. He goes, like you guys are doing right now. He goes, not a lot of these kids do that. Because we were young. I was, you know, I was pretty young at the time and probably like your age. And he's like, yeah, this is the kind of guys like you are the guys I'm trying to raise as hockey players. And it's becoming more and more difficult.
Yeah. It's crazy to think about. I mean, it just kind of shows how good of a person Doug Wu was, you know, being able to be fired, but then he was also jumping right back on and being,
I mean, incredible
with the team and speaking highly of them on the other side of things, you know. And I think for a lot of people that would be really hard to do.
It would,
you know, it would be a lot of people would probably get out of there as fast as he can, right?
Yeah.
He definitely saw kids in a lot of different eras coaching too. So he had a lot of different opinions on things like that. So he was just a good man.
Is it strange, and this wasn't really part of the script, but is it strange for you to think that you are in the same shoes, although a very different style of shoes? You know, he had, it was a pack in town when he was, and there were four or five kids in each of those little tiny houses in South St. Paul. It's a lot different today, but still, at the end of the day, you're still wearing the same shoe as head coach of South St. Paul. Does it seem a little weird that you have that same title as Doug Wu?
Yeah, it's kind of, honestly, I never really thought about it too much before like that. But now that you say that, it is, it's pretty cool. I mean, growing up in South St. Paul, now being the head coach, I don't really know what to say. It's pretty, pretty amazing to follow in the footsteps of someone like that. And I just hope that I can give back as much as he did.
All right. So sticking with the South St. Paul and the legacy of the whole thing, you're obviously a former player, grew up there. I mean, like I said, but it's different. I mean, the car is a lot different today than it is then. Why? Here's a question. Here, and I didn't prep you for this one. You were Pat Griswold's assistant the last two seasons, right? Was it two seasons?
Two seasons.
That program is, you know, they're coming up, right? And Pat's starting to build something, a really nice program there. And you could kind of see some of the fruits of that in the next few years. What was it that drew you to take this job? And I would say this is I wouldn't say it's impossible. Nothing's impossible, but it's a really tall, tall task. What drew you to this job, and what made you decide to accept it or apply for it, or ever, however it worked out?
No, that's a good question. I mean, Pat's done such an amazing job at Holy Angels. He's such a good leader over there, and you can see all the respect from the kids, and they want to play and go and play for him. And that was fun to be a part of. But you know, what ultimately drew me back was, you know, South St. Paul is my alma mater. Just the pride that I have, with being so well connected still to this day, in that city. There's just a lot to go back there and just, and want to help and be part of that again. you know, my dad's obviously got the girl side of things. I'm taking over the boy side of things, which is pretty cool in itself. How cool will that be? Yeah.
The practices will likely, I'm guessing, they butt back to back to one another.
Yeah,
you're going to see them a lot, right? You would think.
Well, we had to go down to the rink a couple weeks ago to try to work out practice
schedule.
Times. Yeah, so it was, okay, girls coach, boys coach, you guys need to go talk to the rink coordinator.
I'm guessing because you have a full-time job, but you're going to want the later time, and he's going to want the earlier, and he's going to want the earlier time because he's a teacher.
I said, Dad, you get out at 2:50, you can take the 3:10 tee time.
Right, tee time, yeah.
It's still summer thinking about golf, but yeah. But yeah, I mean, it was just an opportunity that I felt like I couldn't pass up. You know, it was an opportunity. Both my parents still teach at the school. My brother teaches at the school, and it's just a big part of my my upbringing. So I'm ready for the challenge.
All right. So speaking of your brother Josh, right? He's the oldest, right?
Correct. Yep.
He's the tallest too by a mile, right?
6'4". I don't know where he gets that from. Dave's only 5'9". So,
right.
Sorry, Dave.
Right. So he's a teacher there?
He is, yes.
Right? And he's a coach with your dad. So that brings four Palmquists in the building. Your sister Abby's also on your dad's staff as a JV coach?
JV coach, correct.
And all Palmquists played for the Packers, including your brother Luke, right?
Correct. Luke was the goalie.
He's going, oh my gosh, how many times did you and Josh pepper him?
Oh,
poor kid.
Well, I think he became a goalie
because
Josh were players.
We needed
a goalie out
in the
backyard.
Goalie. Absolutely. I love that. That's so spot on. It is so spot on. Okay, so how did you, was Josh the influence for you to play hockey, or was Dave the influence for you to play hockey? Or was it a neighbor kid?
No, definitely not a neighbor kid.
You know what I mean?
No, for sure. I mean, I think it was a combination of both. I mean, obviously with my dad playing hockey growing up, having the love for it, coaching, definitely got my brother into it. But I think once Josh took on the game, I mean, he was rollerblading around the house when I was still in diapers.
Right.
So seeing him do that, I think, made me want to pursue hockey and get on rollerblades as well, and then eventually the ice.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why I think you needed, in South St. Paul, I think you needed to turn, or maybe this was in Minneapolis when we were still there in the Minneapolis youth organization. I think you needed to turn 4 by a certain time to sign up for hockey. And my mom said, well, he can skate. He turns 4 in December. And this was probably sometime in September.
Yeah.
And they said, well, he can try. And I ended up being on the team as almost a 4-year-old. So I kind of, I guess I can give props to my brother for helping me get on the rollerblades a little bit earlier.
Small world. We lived in Bloomington, and Bloomington wouldn't let him play until he was in kindergarten. So I wasn't going to have that. I was having nothing to do with that. So I had a buddy of mine who lived in Minneapolis, and they said, yeah, if you just fake your address, you can play. So actually they let him play as a 4-year-old in Minneapolis. So we went down to parade every practice.
There you go.
Like 2 days a week, and it worked out great.
That's awesome.
So, all right, let's see here now. So you tell me a little bit about growing up. Who were your coaches growing up in the youth program? Did your dad coach you guys as youth, or did you have a non-parent, a parent coach, kind of someone who kind of drove the passion or helped lead you guys down the road?
Gosh, that's a great question, Tony. You know, as far as my youth coaches, my dad never coached me. He was always just too involved with the high school stuff.
Right.
I'm pretty sure it was some parents.
Yeah.
Can't remember specific names, but,
where'd the passion come from? Where did you go? Like, man, I really love the backyard rink, or I loved the tournaments. What was it about your youth career that was just like, it propelled you? Cause it had to have started somewhere, right?
Honestly, I think it was the success of my dad's teams growing
really?
Up. Really? I mean, I think that's really what made me fall in love with the game is
watching section finals, watching state tournaments, watching the streak,
yes.
Right?
No, it was really cool to be a part of. I mean, I remember when I was 8, 9, 10 years old of running on the rink after the section finals when they knew they were going to the state tournament, you know, like
right.
You're running out there.
Yeah.
and it's the biggest thing in the world, you know? So, I mean, I remember riding on the bus downtown to the XL with the girls getting a police escort, you know?
Yeah. Like, oh in, yeah. South St. Paul, yeah, for sure. That's
right
happening.
Down Concord Street there, yeah, yeah, in St. Paul. So, I mean, those were big moments that I remember of being like, this is awesome. I mean, obviously a lot of great moments from me playing as well, but I remember those more.
Yeah. Okay. So if dad's coaching, mom's trucking.
Oh,
right.
She had four schedules. I don't know how she did it.
And she's Thank a teacher you, Mom. Too.
Yeah.
Right. So she's got, she's dealing with that. Well, dad's at the rink and doing all that stuff too. So tell us a little bit, Mom. I mean, I know she was a teacher. Tell me a little bit about her too.
Yeah. Yeah. My mom, she's the rock of our family, obviously. I mean, like I just mentioned, trying to juggle four schedules in a hockey season is a tough, tough task. She always liked when me and Josh made the same team.
Right. Absolutely. Are you guys 2 years apart?
We're 15 months apart, so we're only one grade apart.
Okay, all right. So you played a lot together.
We played a lot together.
So he was on that 08 team.
He was.
All right, great, okay.
But I remember my first year of squirts, I made the B team, and Josh was on the A team. And my mom, I remember my mom going, are you sure he can't be on the A team? Maybe Josh goes on the B team just so
right.
we have one less schedule.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so granted, my other siblings were a little bit younger, but yeah, eventually when we got older, it was a lot. You know, my mom's the type of person, if you ask her to do something, she's going to do it for you right away for her kids. And, can't thank her enough for trucking us all along throughout the years.
I believe it. Did you guys have a lot of, out of town tournaments? Cause it's becoming huge now where people leave. Did you guys go to many out of town tournaments or was it just one a year?
It was about one or two a year.
Right.
I mean, I
hear
what it is.
That's gotta be hard though. If you have three kids, you know what I mean? Like not on the same team. I mean, and dad's got responsibilities at the rink pretty much all winter long as well.
I'd say we went with, buddies on the team, parents a lot.
Did
over
you?
The weekend, like my mom would pick and choose which tournament she was going to go to.
Right.
Me, Josh, or Luke.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, there was some, it was nice when me and Josh were both in the same team and had the same tournament. But usually we would probably ride up with some buddies.
Yeah,
some
got buddies it. Dads. Got it. All right, so moving on to high school, you know, you look at that 08 team that lost in the section final, just the roster's pretty loaded. I mean, Justin Falk, Adam Wilcox, and you mentioned another kid. Who's the other kid?
Was
Austin
Young.
Austin
was
Young,
freshman,
yeah.
Yeah, played at UMD, yeah.
That's a pretty loaded team.
Yeah, I mean, I look back on that, and it was gosh,
ranked? Like, you must have been a top five team in the state.
I think in Class A, we were two or three.
Yeah, and
St. Thomas
was
number one, I think, all year.
Probably.
We did tie them during the regular season, 2-2.
Was it conference, or was it?
Yeah, that was a conference game. It was at St. Thomas. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we tied them 2-2. I think the other game we lost 5-0 or 6-0 during the regular season. But then when it came to section time, we kind of just told ourselves like, this is anybody's game.
Yeah.
I mean,
they had a really good goalie. You had Wilcox.
We did.
Come on.
I know. He was one of the most, sought after goalies. I think after that year. You know, after his freshman year, where he was getting D1 calls all over the place.
Yeah,
from what I remember. But yeah, I mean St. Thomas, I believe their goalie was Aaron Crandall.
Yeah,
who played at Duluth.
Yeah.
So I mean they had a nice roster as well.
Yeah, that's incredible. Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the whole. We talk about the aura of your family. And the impact that you guys have had on it. Is it a little weird sometimes? Like, is it like too crazy to feel how many people have their hands in South St. Paul hockey in your family like that? I think it's super cool.
Gosh, yeah. I think if anything, I just think it's cool. You know, I mean, it just feels like a family business almost.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, in a
yeah,
in
like
a
pizza
way,
shop, right?
Yeah,
but instead it's hockey. Yeah.
Exactly. I guess I'll just be seeing my parents a lot more than I am right now, so which isn't a bad thing, you know?
Yeah, that's not, so, I never even thought of that.
Yeah, so I live in Eagan now.
Yep.
Which will be kind of nice every time. I mean, I got to go to South St. Paul for practice every day and drop the kids off at grandma's house. And
that's not bad.
You know, if they want a little extra daycare, it's nice.
That's not, I never thought of that. Yeah, that's a bonus.
Yeah.
That's a bonus. Okay. A little personal question. Obviously, there's some coaching, teaching blood in you because your parents both are teachers and your dad's a coach. I can imagine how much is in there. I mean, how badly did you want to coach?
You know, it's funny you ask that because I actually didn't know if I wanted to coach when my hockey career ended.
Yeah. I mean, you probably had hit a wall, too, with your career, like the game of hockey, too, right?
Yeah, I think,
And everybody hits a wall at some point,
right? I just hit a wall. You know, it was like we talked about earlier. It was two COVID years over in Sweden, which...
brutal.
It was just one of those things where we didn't get fans over there, and my love for the game kind of just kept going down and down. But, yeah, it's... I remember Grizz asking me if I wanted a coach when I decided to hang him up. And I remember telling myself a few years, because people are always like, oh, would you get into coaching after you're done playing? And I really thought I want to get away from the rink for a while. I really want to get away from the rink. You know, it's been part of my life since I was 3 years old. But Grizz kept on asking me, and he didn't push. He just said, hey, would love to have you. And I said, you know what? Let's give it a shot. Let's give it a shot. And I fell in love with it right away. Being around the kids, seeing how they responded to things, being on the other side of things, just being out there to push these kids, answer questions of some of the similar things that I've been through in high school, wanting to make it to the next level, can share with them. I mean, honestly, I got to thank Grizz for really pushing me to do that.
How do you and Grizz know each other?
So my dad coached after he was done at he graduated from Bethel University, got the head coaching position at Minnehaha Academy when he was like 23 or 24 years old. So young coach,
coldest rink in the world.
Oh sorry. Man, I know.
Everyone goes, this rink's cold. I'm like, you've never been to Minnehaha.
Seriously, yeah. And he coached his first few years. He coached Grizz on he played for Minnehaha. So they were somewhat close in age, and they just stayed in touch throughout the years after that. And then Grizz was, I mean, he babysat me when I was in diapers. Yeah. So he's like an uncle to me.
Got it.
Yeah.
And that's the Jay Doshin connection.
That's the Jay Doshin connection. Correct.
Got it. Got it. Now it's all coming together. I did that connection, but then I didn't realize how long that you had known Grizz.
Yeah. It's been a long time.
Pat Griswold, head coach of Academy of Holy Angels.
Great guy.
All right. Okay. Now that makes sense. A lot of times coaching itself is, you know, it's the whole, Wayne Gretzky rule, right? Like just because you were great, and I would consider you a great hockey player by estimations playing professionally, just because you're great doesn't make you a great hockey coach. Were you aware of that, or did you wear like, I can't just walk out here because I can probably do this, you know, Mohawk drill better than these guys? Doesn't make me a better teacher of the game, or you know, because you have to have empathy, you have to have sympathy, you have to have, you know, discipline. There's a lot of different, you know, hats that you wear as a coach. When did that hit you? Or has it hit you yet?
No, definitely, definitely has. I just feel like you can't go into being in a position where I was at playing professionally of going into something like this with arrogance or aurora of being better than anybody else. And you just can't stepping into an environment to try to teach kids of what you've done by thinking that way. And
right.
So, I mean, I remember first getting on, like, I just want to help these kids learn. And if I can give them something in a sincere and positive way, I'll be able to help them with whatever they need. You know, like one of my first thing was like, guys, ask me questions. Cause I felt right away when I did step in with Holy Angels is like, some kids were a little timid to come up and ask questions, you know?
Yeah.
So I think just kind of opening that door and being welcoming is the first start to doing that.
And dudes don't ask questions.
No, you gotta pull it out of them sometimes.
Yeah.
And that's hard. But I think if you, like I just said, if you leave that door open and kind of have that inviting feeling around you, it'll come back.
Definitely happen. Okay. All right. Let's walk through the whole process of your career. Before we do that, I just got to take a small little break here. Hey, Minnesota Wild fans. We're less than a month away from the season opener with Florida. Maybe this is the year you get a season ticket package. This year, the Wild offers flex packs for 11 games only. You can get weekday or weekend games. If you're a snowbird, you can watch fall and spring hockey. But my favorite is the Eastern Conference only teams. You can see Boston, Philly, the Rangers, Penguins, Capitals, those types of teams only. I really love it. This year, you should heed the call and become a season ticket member today. All right, let's talk a little bit about your career here. We talked a little earlier about your youth career. When you had this, I want to talk a little bit about the South St. Paul 08 team. Walk through that, the game when you play South St. Paul to go to state. At some point in your brain, because I went through this with myself, and I went through it as a dad too. It's like you're going into a section final game. It's different, right? Because now you're there. You're in the section final. Now you're one game away, and now you start thinking. For me, it was the St. Paul Civic Center, right, or whatever that was. And then for my son, it was the XL Energy Center. And you're thinking, and he's Jefferson, so he's thinking, okay, if I win this game, our mural is, we're going to be on Bloomington Ice Garden forever. I mean, it's those types of things. And Jefferson's great. Don't get me wrong, but South St. Paul, a banner up there with your team on it, that's pretty special. Do those things start entering your 18-year-old, or you were junior that year, 17-year-old brain?
Yeah, I think a little bit. I remember watching Al Stalock go to state with that 04 team.
Right.
And when I saw that banner go up, I don't think there was a previous one since 94.
Correct.
And I think that those thoughts of like, okay, I want to be the next one. We want to put an 08 up there.
Yeah.
Watched Stalock do it. Watched all these guys do it. It would be a pretty cool accomplishment. So, yeah, I definitely think that that's something that's going through your head. Obviously, you know you're playing the number one team in state in St. Thomas, but you played them so competitively, and you knew that this was your team to go to state with.
Yeah.
That you just were like, let's just leave it all on the line tonight.
Yeah. And you played at Aldrich. Walk through the details. Do you have any details of the game you remember?
Gosh, I do remember little detail. I just remember in the third period it was 1-0, and I think Justin Falk had a penalty. We were on the penalty kill, and I was out there on the PK, and his penalty was coming down, or he was about to jump back out on the ice. And somehow me and him both, we had a 2-on-1. It was me and Justin to tie the game. And I mean, Justin can shoot the puck harder than anyone that I know.
Yeah.
And he ripped I don't remember if it was glove hand or maybe low side, but I think it went post to post or post and out.
Yeah.
And we were so close with, there must have been 10 minutes left in the third
to tie
the game. Yeah. That would have tied the game, and he hit the post. That's one thing that I remember, yeah.
That clank you can probably still hear in your sleep. Okay.
Dreams, yeah.
Well, sorry to bring up disappointment. I'm just like, I see this in your records, and I'm like, oh, that's pretty cool, and a really good roster of that team. I'm just like, I got to hear what that's like. It must have been a fun season, though. It must have been a top five team in the state, a lot of wins. Any great memories from high school hockey that, now that you'll have in your brain that you can kind of transfer to the next South St. Paul generation?
I mean, honestly, I just look back on those teams. I mean, I see a lot of my friends from those teams and just think about, like, how close we were. And, like, there weren't cliques in the locker room. Everyone hung out with each other on the weekends. Everyone did stuff with each other after practice. Honestly, I think that that's one thing that I took away from my high school career is, there wasn't any nagging going on between guys in the locker room. We were honestly like a family, and that's what made it really fun, especially the year that we went to sections and then my senior year lost to Matamidi in the semis. But I mean, that's what I'd want to bring back.
Here's a question for you. This just popped up. You said there were no cliques and we were tight and all that stuff. Did you try to maybe, and I'm not saying it was like this or not like this at Mankato, but did you kind of try to transfer a little bit of that mentality? When did you bring a little bit of that mentality with you to Mankato?
Yeah, I mean, I think
maybe it was like that at Mankato. I'm guessing it was like that at Mankato too.
I feel
I have
like,
a reason why, but I just
no. I think it's. I mean, high school hockey. You're with each other for 4 years. Most of your best friends, right?
Right.
And that kind of is the same way in college hockey too. You know, you got your freshman group. You're with them for 4 years. That differs from pro hockey. Guys can be
totally.
Around, you know.
Yeah.
So I think just that college, high school, it's very similar. 4 years, you want to build a program together.
My theory is why you'd be so tight in college is all of you guys came in. I mean, maybe a little bit different with the Gophers or UND or whatever. Like, all you guys kind of came in at the same level, right?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's not like whatever, you know, like we brought in – you know, whatever it was, Logan Cooley. Like, he's a third-round draft pick. Like, you know what I mean? Like, not you guys don't have drafted players, but, like, a third overall pick is that's a unicorn. Even in college hockey, that's crazy, right?
Yeah.
So, but, like, in your guys' case, you're all pretty much the same type of player coming into the school, same goals of making pro hockey. So, you know, like, there's a lot of same. So getting along is going to be pretty easy, I would guess.
Yeah, we're all drinking age when we get there, so all, you know, that makes it
you
easy.
Said it, not
I didn't
me.
Know, I'm just, no, but yeah, I mean, you're right. So a couple guys are, I mean, I remember going into my freshman class thinking, you know, all these guys that play junior hockey, they're right around my same age. They've been kind of through the thick and thin of
Say
things.
That five times,
jeez,
yeah.
No kidding. So, I mean, we all came through similar paths, and I think that just kind of makes you gel pretty well, I guess.
Yeah. I just dawned on me right now why that might be successful. All right. 4 years there, a coaching change after your freshman year. We talked about this before the show. How strange is it that Darren Blue and Todd Knott were retained by Mike Hastings after Troy left the program? And you didn't really have a solid response, but it is a little bit odd these days that a new coach comes in most programs and brings his own staff in. I think Hasty made a really good choice in keeping those two around. Talk about those guys as assistant coaches for all 4 years and the impact they had on your skill development as a player, person, and then maybe even lean on those guys about how you might coach a team.
Yeah, I think one of the first people to reach out to me when I accepted the South St. Paul job was Darren Blue. You know, and me and him were very close. He was the defenseman coach while I was there the whole time. And, you know, and Todd Knott was the forwards coach. So didn't work with him as much one-on-one, but was still a big impact on, you know, the type of person you got to be, how you should act away from the rink, just like those things of being a pro. And both of them were very influential for me when I did eventually turn pro. And you can see why, you know, Darren is now retired from coaching, but you can see why Hastings still brought Todd Knott to Wisconsin with him.
Oh, yeah.
You know, he's a top-notch coach. He's a good recruiter. You can see why Mankato has had so much
success.
Todd
loves recruiting.
Oh, he loves it. He's one of the best. One of the best.
Loves it. I've never seen a coach more in a building than that guy. Like the Division I coach, there's not – he has the most – when I'm in a lot of buildings, and I that's the one I saw the most.
Yeah, I mean, he puts in the work to go find those players, and he might find that diamond in the rough because he is taking that time to
– see him that extra time. Mm. You know, the Cade – he must have saw Cade Borchert play.
Mm.
It felt like – he was illegally watching how many times he watched. And I mean that sincerely. I mean, I'm joking. But, like that's the type of work he puts in.
Yeah, yeah. No, he was – I mean, I remember my time there. I mean, he was – there would be some times where it was just Darren Blue and Mike Hastings on the bench because he's up in Canada going to watch kids.
Well, think about their super successful teams a couple years ago, all the foreign players they had.
Yeah.
So how much time is he spending there?
Right.
Right?
Well, I mean, most of those foreign players are playing over here in the States.
Yeah.
But yes, you're right. I mean, Does he go and make home visits over in Germany in the summer? I'm not
no
sure.
No idea. No idea. I know Michaelis was here for a long time.
He was.
So yeah. I mean, just as one example, but there was a lot more than Mark that were coming through that program. Okay. So Hasty. So what would you draw from him as a high school coach? Like what if I did one thing what he's gonna do, how would you copy him?
Yeah, I think one thing that stuck with me is his professionalism as far as, you know, knowing when to turn it off and knowing when he got to know his players. You know, he knew what to do to get some guys going. He knew when to kind of back off a little bit.
Right.
You know, like he got to know us, and I think that was really cool. He kept us accountable. You know, it was always please and thank yous. And
what do you mean by please and thank yous? I mean, I know what that means when I tell my kid to go to sleepover, but does that the same apply to a hockey team too?
Yeah, no, when we went out to dinner as a team at restaurants, it's please and thank you to the restaurant owner and thanking them for our time. They hold the door open for us. You better be saying thank you or else you're going to hear it from Mike.
No way. Yeah.
And
I can stop the pod right now. That's good stuff
For sure. And I think that.
You know what I mean by please and thank? I'm sure your parents, when you went to sleep, were like, all right, when you go over there, Zach, make sure you say thanks to Mr. Johnson. Yeah. Or whatever. Yeah. It's the same thing. Basically the same principle, right?
No, for sure. I mean, it's like I tell my 4-year-old son after I hand him a couple chicken nuggets or whatever he wants for a snack. I mean, what do you say? You know, and I think that especially for college kids who are coming into a D1 program thinking they're the big stuff around there.
Oh yeah,
you gotta, you know, and
especially
I think
the only Division 1, including the women, right?
Like exactly,
it's huge.
Yeah,
it's
shrink your head.
Funny you should say that. My high school coach, Jim Baxter, who coached and went to Minnehaha as well. By the way, just a little tidbit there. Yep. Coach Jack Blatherwick, I'm sure you know that, right? So Jim Baxter's a legend, 600 wins. He would make us say thank you to the bus driver getting off the bus every time. And he would say, everybody, we know the rules. We get off the bus. And you knew, I mean, sophomore, junior, he said thank you. So much that was ingrained in me. I remember I was, like, taking my kids to Disney in 2007. I'm getting off one of those shuttle buses. I lean over to the lady and I say, thank you. And I get off the bus. I'm like, why did I just thank the Disney bus driver? Mm-hmm. But Mr. Baxter had that thing so ingrained in our brains that it will never leave. I never get off a bus without saying thank you to the bus driver.
No, it's good, though. It's great. It's just those little things I feel like can go a long ways.
Absolutely huge. All right. So let's talk a little bit career at you guys had a wonderful run when you were there. All-American, second team All-American. Do you get like a mural? Do you get your face on a mural like they do at Mariucci? You should have one.
I think there's a banner up.
Should be a banner with your name on it?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah.
I think there is. Yeah. I was there last fall. I think I did see your name on a banner. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. Two times WCHA first team. That's impressive. When you look back at, you know, Zach's career at Minnesota State, what's the one thing, you know, man, I'll never forget this. You know, we talked earlier, you were basically number one in the country your entire senior year. What's that great memory for you?
Yeah, I mean, there's obviously a lot. Like you just mentioned, being the number one team in the country and kind of putting Mankato on the map.
I think
that was, people were like, who is this team? You know, we were 10, 12, 11 win team my freshman year. And then
that they turned it around so quickly was just such a unbelievable testament to the players in that room.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think, you know, going back to my junior year of being I think we were number one in the country for a little bit. But then senior year, we were number one for a while. I don't know. It's just putting us on the map, kind of getting Mankato's name out there a little bit bigger on the bigger stage of things. And then I think at the end of the day, I think just how many friends I've that came out of it as well. You know, that's perfect. I think that's a pretty cliche thing to say, but
no, it's actually I've never heard that before.
Okay.
I thought it was cool. We were talking before the show about that crazy no goal call in the CCHA or WCHA playoffs, and like how you and your buddies were texting about it.
Oh yes.
The thing about it is, you know, 13, 14, 15 was where the foundation was laid for that team to be where it was, and for them to be at the Frozen Four in Boston. I mean, like, that stuff's special.
Yeah, it was pretty cool as an alum to see that. And I remember texting Hasty and Bluey right away and Nodder just saying, congrats, this is so cool. See you guys on ESPN.
Yeah.
Making it to the national championship game. I mean,
beating the Gophers, too, by the way.
Beating the Gophers, yes.
Handily.
I loved it. I loved it. Just seeing all the success, it doesn't get much better.
Yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, so you turn pro. This is more of an education for the turning pro crowd out there. You turn pro. You get signed. Now, you played for the Iowa Wild. Were you under contract with the Minnesota Wild? How does that work?
Yeah, good question. So right when
I honestly don't know the answer to this.
Yeah, I'll try to give you the short answer.
Yeah.
A couple days later after my season ended at Mankato.
And you knew, were you being courted prior to this? Or did you have any idea?
No, I had no idea.
No idea.
No idea.
And you knew it was in the cards. Obviously, if you're a second-team All-American, you're not going to the coast.
I didn't find that out.
You're not going to the coast. Okay.
I mean, honestly, I was just hoping that something would come along.
But your agent at this time has not gone, yeah, I've heard from the Rangers. Or I heard from the – or maybe they can't hear from them? Or
– I mean, I think –
honestly, I'm just curious.
No, that's – I think
– I mean, this wasn't like you had a cup of coffee in the AHL. Like, you were a legit night-in, night-out player for 4 years.
Yeah, it was – I think my agent said something to me, I want to say around Christmas time. And then I remember talking to him, like, hey.
And that was it.
You know, And I said, okay, we'll talk about this at the end of the year. You just go concentrate.
We're number one in the country.
We're number one.
Just leave me alone, right? And it was kind of a bunch of lasts, too. My last home series, my last this, you know, whatever. There's a lot
for
of
sure.
lasts, too, right?
For sure.
So, like, you want to enjoy that moment, not worry about the future. And you knew pro hockey was pretty good chance.
Yeah, I mean, obviously that was the goal. I felt like I put myself in a position to get a look at the end of the season.
Yeah.
And then when I got the call from my agent, probably 2 or 3 days after our season ended, and said, do you want to sign with the Minnesota Wild? And I just remember.
Laughed.
Yeah, I was like, are you serious? And he goes, yeah, I'll send over the papers if you want to sign. So it was a no-brainer. And so, yes, to answer your question, I signed a contract with the Minnesota Wild. The contract that I signed, it was a player tryout just for the end of the season for
Iowa. Right,
because
you played like a handful of games.
8 games,
I think.
Yeah,
yeah.
But the actual contract was for the next season coming up. That would have been with the Minnesota Wild. So I think Minnesota can have some 53 NHL contracts under them.
And you were one of those 53.
I was one of those 53. But, I mean, those can range from a one-way to a two-way contract.
Can you explain what that means? Sorry. I mean, you obviously know what it means. I hear that all the time, and I kind of probably could do the math on what it is, but quickly.
Essentially, a one-way contract is you're guaranteed NHL
money.
Even if you're in the AHL. Yep. Two-way is...
There's two contracts, right?
One for
when
the
you're
AHL.
With us, you're getting paid...
Correct.
X. When you're with them, you're getting paid Y.
Correct. Essentially, you want to try to get the one-way.
Right. Yeah. That's probably only reserved for, like, the first-round draft pick.
Yeah,
types,
those
right?
are for the guy. I mean, for the most part, those are the guys if they're called up and down from the AHL to the NHL a lot, or can and hopefully be a mainstay with the NHL team.
Yeah, I figured that. Okay, so you signed the contract. Did you have options?
I think there were a couple other teams in the mix. I don't remember who, but I think there was two others. But it was the most interest from Minnesota. So it was just a no-brainer.
Most interest, and you're only playing 3 hours. There's no other minor league team going to be remotely close to 3 hours from home. And you self-admittedly, before the show, said you're a homebody. You love your family, love being close to
love
home.
My family.
Right?
Yeah. No,
I love
seriously.
It. I love it.
I got very lucky.
Okay, so you signed the contract. Who were your coaches when you were down there?
My first year was Torchetti. David Torchetti?
Yeah. Torch. Who ended up coaching the team like interim basis, right?
Yes. So I think it was my first year he got, I guess you could say, called up as a coach.
For sure he was. That's kind of cool.
Which was really cool. Torch was great. He's high-intensity guy. High-intensity.
Yeah.
Intensity. Sorry.
Would you think of yourself as that as a coach?
I'd say I'm a little bit different than Torchetti.
Okay.
For sure.
All right. But who's more intense, Pat Griswold or Torchetti?
Oh, Torchetti.
Really?
Chris can get there, but Torchetti he's on a whole nother level. Yeah.
All right. You've never sat by Pat at a Gopher football game,
apparently. I need to join him, I guess. Yeah. Pat, if you see this, invite me. Thanks.
All right. Yeah. It'd be nice to get an invite, right?
Yeah, seriously.
Come on. All right. Okay. So Torch was one coach. Who was the next one?
Gosh. Derek Lalonde was my coach for 2 years.
That's right.
Derek Lalonde. Yeah. He's the head coach of the Red Wings now.
Yep.
Great guy. He's, I'd say, polar opposite from Torchetti as well.
Really?
He's mellow, but he can have his moments for sure. But he's just a lot more, hey, let's go talk on this one-on-one, you know?
Yeah. I'm not going to embarrass you in front of everybody.
Right.
You know, the old, that's a great leadership concept.
Yeah. Right? He was the guy that
praise in public, criticize in private, right? Or whatever.
Call anybody out during video. He wouldn't say the name of, you just say, hey, this guy here, or this guy here, he needs to go here. Where Torchetti, he wasn't afraid to, Palmquist, you got to move that puck quicker. You got to get that out. Stuff like that.
Yeah. I could definitely see how he would get pretty intense. And those coaches have, I wonder if he was like that with the big club.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
I'm not going to take that, right? I've never been in an NHL regular season locker room, but I wish I could. I always try to ask somebody that play, like, how do the head coaches deal with some of these star players?
Or right. Yeah.
Do they call guys out? I don't know.
I don't either.
Good question. You're going to have to get a NHL
so
player in here.
Did you have any minor league games with the Wild?
I played.
You put the real sweater on, for lack of a better term?
I did two preseason games.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Oh, yes.
That's what I meant. Did I say minor league? I meant preseason.
Preseason.
Wish I could edit that part out. Idiot.
Yes, I played one game in Columbus against the Blue Jackets.
Okay.
And then,
really? So it was in their barn?
It was in their barn, yeah.
It wasn't like some offshoot Indianapolis game or something?
No, it was pretty cool. I remember being so nervous when we touched down there. Oh, I don't know. It was just something about being in the NHL rink, you know, putting on the real sweater.
Yeah.
What
number do you remember you were?
My first year, I think it was 50,
it's just some 58. Lame number.
I think. And then I was 52 when I played in Winnipeg 1 year. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Ugh. Okay. So you did 3 years there, and then you went to, was it Allentown?
Allentown. Yep.
Okay. And
Flyers.
What Flyers? Okay.
Yeah.
And who was the coach there? Do you remember that?
That was, I'm just blanking right now. you should have had me research these before.
I know. I got the teams. I don't have the coaches.
Yeah. Nothing's coming to my head right now.
All right. No, I'm sorry to put you on the spot. No. All right. So any takeaways of playing for a different organization? Were there a difference between a Flyers organization and the Wild, or were they pretty much the same?
I mean, pretty much the same. I'm glad because I had an opportunity to come back with the Iowa Wild early on that summer.
After Allentown?
No. Before Allentown.
Okay, got it.
So I decided that I wanted to try something different. You know, being with Iowa Wild for 3 years, I was like, hey, let's go try something different. And I got that opportunity with them. And I'm glad that I did it. Got me away from home a little bit. Got to go experience the East Coast a little bit. But as far as the hockey goes and the I mean, it's
how you're treated.
Same. Yeah.
Fans, same amount of fans.
You know, Des Moines is tough just because they have a great fan base. But their rink is so big, sometimes it can feel a little bit small.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
I mean, it holds like 15. They get like 6 or 7.
Which is good.
Which is great.
Yeah.
But they just took off the top bowl, it would be an electric.
Yes.
So
yes. How about Allentown?
That's where it kind of differs. Allentown got great crowds every night, but their rank actually holds some of the regionals for
yes.
NCAA.
Oh, I've seen that. Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Which I think the rank holds like 5,500.
So it's perfect.
It's a great AHL rank. And it's a great
regional.
Did you
ever play Hershey? I'm sure you did.
Yeah.
Barn must sounds just awesome.
Oh, Hershey was I didn't realize the rivalry. I mean, I don't know much about the East Coast before
right.
I go there. I've never been out there playing hockey, but you learn about these rivalries pretty quickly. I mean, the Hershey Bears, you know, I mean, it was packed. I remember the first time I played in there, like people are yelling, screaming at you, coming onto the ice. I mean, you're only 40 minutes
and you must
away.
Have played there a handful of times, probably
four
times,
six, something.
Is it true that when you get off the bus or you're in Hershey, Pennsylvania, you can smell the chocolate? Is that true or false?
Gosh, I wish I could go back and tell you in real time.
I'd heard that. I'm like, you know, sometimes like there's a candle guy makes candles, this manufactured by our house, and I sometimes can smell it. I'm like, now this is what it's like to be in Hershey, but they get chocolate
and
I get candles.
Yeah, I can't recall, but I'm sure if I went there again, I wouldn't doubt that there's probably something out there.
All right, let's go over the last leg of your career. I wish we could talk about like traveling being across the pond, but it really wasn't. I mean, I'm sure the hockey was fantastic, but being in Sweden, 1920, which led into the end of your season. I'm sure you didn't finish playoffs because it was March, correct?
It was right at the beginning of March. I remember stepping out. We played one game. We were the number one seed.
What was the name of the team?
Björklöven. Björklöven Birchleaves.
And where is that in regards to Stockholm?
It's 6 hours straight north.
Oh, no way.
We were up there. Yeah,
so like Warroad, basically.
Basically, yes. I mean,
how big was the town?
I mean, it was 50,000. It was one of the bigger towns up there.
Oh, okay.
It was definitely one of the bigger towns.
So it was a big town. All right.
It was a great town. Yeah, I mean, our rink held 5,500 fans, and it was packed out every single night.
Really?
And especially the first year I was there, we were the number one team in the league. We got the number one seed. So I played in the second league over there, the Allsvenskan. And so if we would have won that league that first year, we would have jumped up to the SHL.
Yeah.
Which would have been, obviously, I don't think Björklöven has done that since the early 90s or something. I remember our coach saying, boys, if we win this, you're not going to have to ever buy a drink in this town ever again. You know, like,
really?
It's huge. It was really, really fun. And then I remember I was getting ready on the bench for game two. Our coach happened to be on the bench, and he goes, I think this will be our last one. Sounds like they're shutting everything down.
No.
And right after that game, sure enough, the first game we had a sold-out rink at our place, and I think we went to Modo Hockey right down about 45 minutes south, and they didn't have any fans that game, and then boom.
So where are you in year two married? No one kid? No kids?
We had one kid that first year, yeah. So,
he was – was he born, Asher, born in Sweden?
He was born 2 months before I left over there.
Okay, so he was born in the States.
He was born in the States.
All right, but he's with you guys. You get this little baby with you when you're in Sweden. Okay, all right. Which isn't that hard, as you know now, with two kids. One little one isn't. It's overwhelming, but it's not as hard as two or three would be.
Well,
right?
It's nice, especially since mom, I mean, that was her sole focus too.
Yeah.
You know, like I could, you know, go do my thing at the rink, concentrate on that. And to know that he was being taken care of from my wife is obviously nice.
That's super cool. All right. So how do you get, I'm guessing you had an apartment there, you know, you were on a temporary 1 year type of lease or whatever that, or 9 month lease, whatever. How do you get home? You're like in a foreign country and everything is shutting down. Planes are shutting down. Was that a crazy tale, or did you just hop on a plane and come home, pack your stuff, and go home?
That was we literally.
Because you got was there?
Yeah.
Okay. Here's a question.
Yeah.
When you're in Sweden, did you get the in 2 weeks everything's going to be fine, or was it like we're shutting down? Pack your stuff, Zach, and get out of here.
No, that was. I honestly thought I was going to come home for 2 weeks because I mean, I still watched American news over there.
Yeah,
too.
Yeah.
I mean, it was like, okay, 2 weeks, slow the spread. We're going to get back to right. normal here. And that's what we kind of all thought. I said, if I go all the way back home to Minnesota
and they have to
call me back to go finish, I'm going to be kind of, I mean, yes, I want to win and go up, but at the same time, that seems like a lot. If I'm home, I'm home.
Correct.
You know?
So what happened?
So, I mean, right after that game, they basically said, hey, pack up your stuff. We need to get you out of here in the next 2-3 days.
So, like, I mean, out of here.
Out of the country.
So you knew 2 weeks was not the 2 weeks you were hoping for.
No. And we literally had, I think we brought like 8 suitcases over there, 9 with my hockey bag. I mean,
right.
They brought luckily we had some other Minnesota guys on the team. Tyler Vessel was on the team yep. with me, Justin Crandall. So we all got on the same flight back over. But it's funny being on a big plane. I mean, we had I think there was maybe 25 people on our plane of a
really?
250 passenger plane.
Well, that's good for your luggage.
Oh,
purposes.
It was awesome. It was awesome for us. I remember laying down in the middle, falling asleep with my son. Yeah. I mean, we loved it. I said, this is the way I want to fly the rest of my life.
Yeah, for sure.
So, yeah, it was bizarre because people, I mean, you recall, nobody knew really what was going on.
Right.
You know, what's happening? What do you mean there's a pandemic now, you know? So
yeah, we didn't know what that word meant.
Yeah,
Everyone knew what the word epidemic meant, but they didn't know what a pandemic meant. That's worse than an epidemic. I'm like,
right.
That's awful. So then you move home. Did you guys have plans? What were your plans was year one?
That was year
so
one.
So you went back for year two.
Correct.
And then you had a bunch of protocols and all the stuff that everyone else went through in 2021, right? That was really crazy. Did you guys play a full season?
We did play a full season that next one.
Made playoffs?
We made the playoffs. We were the number one seed again and got second.
Oh, really?
So we played the finals. We didn't move up.
Oh, wow.
We got second. We lost in the finals.
Did you know at that time, where in your brain at that time did you go, hey, this might be it. I might be done. I want to move on. I want to get a job working for Jade Ocean. That's really what I want.
You know what? I think it was probably midway through that last year.
Okay.
Just start like, I think not having fans, really did it. I mean, showing up to a big game, regular season or playoffs, you got to be pumped up. You should have the blood flowing. You should be ready to go. And when I stepped on that ice, it didn't feel the same. And that should, it should feel that way with fans or without fans, in my opinion.
That's a really good point.
So when I started to feel that, it was like maybe this is the time. My son's 6 months old now, 5 months old. We want to have pretty kids back to back, you know, here.
Yeah.
We just bought a house the summer before. Like, is it time to move back and just kind of get life going? I'm going to eventually have to get a job anyways. Do we just start it maybe 3-4 years earlier than I probably initially thought?
It's interesting you talk about that because when you said, you know, like word association, when you said, yeah, step on the ice for a big game, I watched the 21 state tournament at the XL Energy Center with nobody in the building. Mm. And I just kept saying to everybody, and I hate to sound like too sappy, but I kept saying, there was a semifinal between Eden Prairie and Maple Grove that was epic, and then there was a championship between Lakeville South and Eden Prairie that was epic. These two games were just so good. And I kept thinking to myself, if that barn was packed, these poor kids were just robbed of two of the greatest hockey games I've watched in the state tournament in a long, long time. And they were excited when they won, but I think they basically got kicked out of the building after they won. And this sounds like some really gory details. I don't want to get into that. But, like, go back to that. Like, it was the same kind of thing where it was playoffs and you're playing to get out of, relegation or whatever that term is. You want to get up. And there's a lot on the line here. Should have been 5,500 people. And you'd seen what 5,500 people looks like.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the year before, we saw 5,500 home fans. I mean, I remember just being so jacked up and pumped to play in that game. And just a year later, you're just like,
it's hard.
It's hard. It's really hard.
It's really hard.
Because that is, I mean, I'm making going to golf now, but I remember Rory when they went have fans on the. He goes, I just don't feel the same energy out here.
No,
you know, and he, I mean, there's a big time professional athlete, one of the top golfers in the world, saying that. So I mean, hearing him say that, I mean, I guess makes me feel a little bit better. But yeah, that's a big part of the game.
Here's a oddball story, kind of related to that. I have a friend of mine from high school. She married a professional baseball player. And I think he did quite well, played in some World Series, just a your typical 10-year career in Major League Baseball. And I remember meeting him at some outing or event, and I asked him about fans or playing for different jerseys. He finished in Detroit kind of thing. And, you know, did you feel like he was he said something to me that I'll never forget. He says, the reason we play is because of the fans. We obviously all love baseball. Tony, he goes, you love baseball too. I'm like, yeah, we all love baseball, but the reason we keep doing this is these full buildings. You know what I mean? Yeah, like,
for sure.
Which kind of goes to what you were saying. Like, and I remember thinking, like, that is bull. You know, you played for the money. That's what I was probably thinking at the time. But I mean, like, we're all going to make a certain amount of money no matter what. But the fans is what makes is the real pay.
Yeah, 100%. I mean,
you know what I mean? 47,000 fans at Yankee Stadium is the real, that's the payment.
Yeah.
The cash, I mean, we're all going to have certain levels, but the payment is 47,000 fans or 5,500 fans or these kids I'm talking high school, 19,000 fans at the X. That's the pay.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you're spot on. It's I mean, I remember coming out winning our first game that first season I was over in Sweden. I mean, fans, it's like European soccer over there.
Yeah.
There's flags waving in the crowd the whole time.
Scarves, afterward, the whole deal,
I mean,
right?
The whole deal. I mean, that's what makes you want to come to the rink right there. Honestly.
Right.
I mean, yes, I've been playing hockey since I was little. And
you played against
the sport,
with 34 parents in the stands,
yeah,
and that was
I know,
awesome, too.
That was awesome, but.
But 5,500 is pretty sweet.
Pretty
or
cool.
Your building down at Mankato, it
yeah.
gets rocking.
It's
I mean,
rocking.
That is a great atmosphere in that building.
It's a great atmosphere.
Absolutely great, man. Okay. Yeah. All right. So we're going to wrap up your career. We're going to talk a little bit about your coaching in a second. Hey, Wild fans. Here's a great idea for your next team outing. Get 8 or more of your teammates and go see the best players in the world. Group ticket sales opportunities include intermission skates, blue line buddies, playing games at the X, and getting your team's name on the scoreboard. For more information, contact group sales at the Wild. All right. We talked a little bit earlier in the show about coaching. I loved what you had to say about, you know, your past coaches. Super cool to hear about those guys. Todd, you pronounce it Knott. I call him Knott. Like, everyone in Red Lake Falls calls it Knott.
I think I called him Knott the first time I met him, Mr. Knott. But it's definitely Todd Knott.
Knott. Weird.
Yeah.
Oh, man, I'm going to get killed for that. Because I've met Knotts. I've met his cousins.
Oh, sure.
And
sure.
They say Knott. Everyone... I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. Well, maybe I'm just an idiot.
Maybe I'm wrong.
I don't think so. I don't think so. No big deal. I think it's probably one of those tomato. Either way,
yeah.
You get it right. Kind of last
sure.
names, you know. So, I loved hearing about those influences, though. It's fun to hear, you know, what you know where your basis is, but you really can't leave out your dad. I haven't really talked much about him. And watching, you know, we talked about Wooger. We talked about a lot of people. Let's talk a little bit about your dad and having him in the building. I know it's not going to be easy. Your first couple years is not going to be easy. How do you look at him? How will you look to him as an influence?
Yeah. I mean, obviously my dad's having an influence on me my entire life throughout my career, you know, supporting me wherever I've been, which has been awesome. And I feel like it's just kind of the same thing. Looking to him now for coaching. He's been doing it for a long time. He knows the ins and outs. He has helped a lot of good players get to where they eventually want to be, and that's pretty cool. So honestly, I just feel like I just have to lean. I mean, I remember even in my playing career, I called my dad after every single game. Every single game
no
I
way.
Called him, and we talked about the game. We didn't really get into – hey, how do you think it went tonight? Yeah, I thought you looked really good. You know, stuff like that. Hey, I think you could have done this a little bit better. But every single game I called my dad. I feel like it's going to be very similar now getting into coaching. Granted, he's probably going to be a lot more games than my playing career since he's right there in South
right.
St. Paul. But you know, I think it's just going to him to ask for advice on little things, you know. Yes, the coaching side, it's a lot different. Being an assistant coach last year, it's a lot different than being on the ice. Got a lot more things to worry about, and especially as a head coach, there's going to be things out of your control. There's going to be things that come up. There's going to be maybe some, you know, system stuff you want to ask on. You know, hey, this isn't working. What do you think? You know, yes, I played at a high level, but maybe he's probably looked at a lot more systems than I have. I didn't really have to think about that as a player. I was just told what to do, you
correct.
Know? So, I think all those things are going to combine to having him help me in a lot of different ways.
This just dawned on me that I know this guy. He was a, like, all-star, we'll call him, Bantam AA coach. Won state a few times, and great hockey coach, great hockey mind, could break down power plays, X's and O's, the whole deal. Then he got a high school job, and he's done quite well, but not – he's won state yet, but he's done quite well. And he says to me one day, he goes, I had no idea how much administrative stuff goes into being a high school coach at this level. I'm like, well, what do you mean? He goes, you know, at Bantam's, there's a team manager who does basically everything. They set the schedule. I might tell him what tournament to play in, or, you know, we might have a scrimmage this team or that team. But for the most part, I just showed up and coached. And now there's, you know, all the meetings and all of the scheduling is on my plate. Everything is on my plate as the coach. And you as an assistant probably don't see any of those. And now it's like, oh, yeah, here's this. Basically, it's a sink full of dishes that you got to clean, and no one else is going to clean it for you.
Yeah, no, I hear people all the time say assistant coaches is the best gig in the world.
Absolutely.
You show up to practice.
Show up, slapping backs, good cop. Yeah. Don't deal with any of the parents, any of the letters, any of the stuff.
No, definitely. And I remember Grizz saying that to me too earlier this summer, you know. But he just said it. I mean, he was very happy for me when I did take this position, but
he was ecstatic.
Oh, he was more than happy for me. But I mean, hey, you're gonna be a lot more busy, just so you know that, you know.
You sounded just like him there, by the
did
way.
I?
That was perfect.
I'll have to listen to that one back. But yeah, I mean, I kind of had a heads up of what it's gonna look like, but I mean, it's just part of it, and I'm excited for it.
Walk through the building, because, like, I'm not saying there's not a lot of kids playing. I know this from on my youth hockey side of it. We don't see a lot of South St. Paul teams in our tournaments. We don't see them in the top 10 in rankings. We're not seeing it's not what it used to be. Even when I started here, I mean, there were some good South St. Paul Bantam A teams back in the day. Tell me what it's going to take. What are your plans as a coach and as a community to kind of help start the building blocks and get it back to respectability?
Yeah, I mean, that's obviously been on my mind ever since I took this position. And, you know, talking with the homegrown South St. Paulers that have been here since they were kids, I mean, it's going to take a community. I said that in the interview process as well. You know, it's going to take a community. I can't do it by myself, and I'm gonna have to use my resources, use people that are around the community that have been around these kids to you know, grow the numbers, grow the love in the sport, grow the passion to play for your hometown team when you get to that point of where do I go to high school for hockey. And you know, I think that starts with outreach to you know, just try to get ingrained with the youth as much as you can. What that looks like is still a building block for me of what that's specifically going to look like.
I always say it's the kindergarten back to school. That's where you start.
Yeah.
You know, that's where you find kids that don't know, you know, what sport that they want to play because they're only 5 years old. But like, as you know, I mean, you got to be 5, 6, 7 years old in order to really excel at this sport, because you know darn well there's kids in Matamidi, for example, they're playing. They got a 60 kids, 60 right. mites in Matamida. I'm just using it as an example. Yeah. Like, well, how are we going to beat these guys if we don't have 60 mites or 30 mites or 30 kids? Just need 30 kids, you know, per grade. And pretty soon you can build a heck of a program. But like I said, how do you get, you know, it's easier said than done. But I think once they step in the door and they can get past the first three or four falls on the ice, because everybody falls their first time, then it's easy.
Yeah, no, I think you're spot on. I think, I mean, I can't, like I said, it's not a one-person job. I'm going to have to tap into resources around the community to get those numbers up, to have kids fall in love with the game, and going to have to continue to do that. I can't be everywhere at once, unfortunately.
No.
You know, but just to get my face in the community and try to be there for the youth and try to be there for the middle-aged kids, yeah, it's going to be – I think it's going to be really a good challenge for me and my coaching staff this year.
So you talked about Coach Schultz, what an impact he had. Mm-hmm. He was a coach, assistant coach when you were playing, correct?
Correct. Yep.
And now he's stepped away. And well, tell me some of the things he said about, you know, being remaining involved as a Packer.
Yeah, I mean, Schultz, he leads the maroon and gold.
It's Peter Schultz,
Peter
right?
Schultz.
Yeah, right,
yeah. Schultzy. Yeah, he's been a great friend of mine since I was, you know, in ninth grade. He was my football coach for a little bit. I was a quarterback in ninth grade, and he was my quarterback's coach. That's
really?
Where it kind of started.
Yeah.
Before the hockey season started that year. But, yeah, he was my assistant coach all 4 years in high school. And, I mean, he just loves South St. Paul hockey. He's got a kid that's going to be a sophomore this year.
Oh, wow. That's probably a reason he stepped aside.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, no more ball, right?
I think it's good for him. He's going to, you know, watch from a distance, and
maybe absolutely.
I'm sure his son, he might be. I know I would be happy if,
absolutely.
My dad's stepping aside. Dad, can you let me do this? But, I mean, a guy like that who's been around the program for so long, you know, having conversations with him, you know, wanting to give back to the community even more than he already has. Of
correct,
Zach, let's build the youth numbers together. You know,
stuff
like
cool
that is really awesome. So. Hearing things like that even before I took the position is really a motivating factor for me too. So, and I know that he's got a network of other people that feel the exact same way.
It's not impossible. See, here's why I say it's not impossible. You can look around. There's other communities that are building hockey programs all over the state. And here's why. This is my weekly or daily pump up how great Minnesota is. But you have the Minnesota Wild. You have a pro team that people are familiar with, right? You have six Division One teams, six Division One teams, mm-hmm. In the state of Minnesota. It's a great community, and I think once people see how welcoming our community can be to people, even like you think, for how many people that play, you'd think that hockey would be more snobby. Mm. They're the farthest thing. Like they want everyone to experience how great it is to play the game. So I think once you get them. So that building, I think the rest is easy.
For sure.
No, you know, that's the hard part is just getting them there, you know, getting them there and realizing that it doesn't cost more money than basketball or whatever winter sport, because they're all, these days, all youth sports are going to be expensive.
Well, with hockey these days, it's nice that they have these programs for younger kids to get equipment for free.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's what you need.
Yeah, just get it free. Once they get, we talk about falling. I did this with my son and my daughters, like just put breezers on them. Because once they fall on their butt and it doesn't hurt that bad, they're going to try harder. You know, that's the key is like get them some breezers, get them some gloves, get them a helmet, and they'll get out there and skate. And, you know, the rest is, you know, history, I think.
Spot on.
Well, I'm excited for your career as a coach and to get to know you and come out and watch you guys play. And hey, even if we're lucky, we might even get a jersey in here. What are the odds of that? You know, now I feel like Danny Ryan, you know, soliciting jerseys during a podcast.
Yeah, but
it's not definitely not the first. So
you guys will have to make it out to a game for sure.
We definitely will. Anything else you want to share about your program, your vision?
No, I mean, last thing I'll say, I think, thanks for having me on, but I mean, I'm just excited to get things going. I want tryouts here as quickly as possible. Honestly,
in
November.
It.
I mean, it's close, but it still feels far away.
I believe it.
So I'm very excited to start just getting it going.
Getting it going. Well, thanks for joining us.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Zach Palmquist, South St. Paul High School.
Love is a burning thing.